I've got two cones here that make a triangle with a point here. You jump forward and you plant on your left and you jump and rotate and land forward on this one.
So like
one.
A reckless type of very 180 similar, or yeah, a 90 there?
180. But what we can do is alter that, move this back one in a little,
uh-huh,
jump forward, jump backwards, land on the plate backwards. What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Garage Strength Podcast, sponsored by, are these sponsored by Range Meal Bars?
I think they are sponsored. 700 calories. I still can't get over that.
Yo, and I'm here with four-time co-author, world champion of the year.
Don't forget my crown.
And crown of the king of the PA press, yeah. Earl Kunkel. He can PA press more than most people can back squat.
Oh, I guess actually, dude, probably can.
People back squatting 250, like, that's, yeah, not happening.
I know.
Most people, I mean, people watching this podcast, dude, I want to tell you.
Are those, is it NARP or whatever?
Yeah, not athletic, regular person. David Lucas has a shirt that says that. We had a guy in the chat today, Harry. I think it's Harry from UK, if I remember. And he goes, I started listening to Masters of Sport podcast, so he hadn't been at the point where we changed the name. And this was, he was like, I found it 7 days ago. I'm now on episode 31. And he goes, dude, he was bringing up stuff that I've forgotten. He's like, my goal is to catch up by 2 weeks from now. And I was like, what? He's like, dude, I'm all in. And he told me the pod, like the one he's at. Like, dude, we probably filmed those almost 2 years ago.
Yeah. And I remember when we started, I said to you, I was like, I can show up every day for a year. Are you going to be able to do it too? And it's almost 2-3 years now.
I think it's 2 years.
2 years.
I want to say it's two years.
We said we would need about a half a decade.
Yeah.
Like
to get
somewhere
there.
Around like 3-5 years.
So we're getting close. Yeah.
And whatever. At this point, it's just, it's in the routine. It's fun.
I think that's the other thing is it's like, I mean, this is almost what we were talking about off air, is like something like a podcast. So many people start them and stop them. And I probably had like five before I did this.
Yeah.
And then you also have one.
I am a persistent SOB. I will tell you that.
And it's like, okay, if we can stay in, and this is what I was saying off the air. It's like, if you stay in the game long enough, dude, when you're persistent, and both of us are very persistent, we have Pennsylvania Dutch in us, so we're bullheaded. Yeah. And that also means we'll do the same dumb shit way too many times before we learn from it.
Yeah, we will.
And that's my forte, is just being really stupid.
Yeah, but
just doing it enough that my stupid outlasts other people's intelligence. And I foresee that should be a clip that we put on Instagram.
My stupid will outlast people's intelligence.
That's a quote. That should be a Dane Miller t-shirt.
You need
quote.
A t-shirt like with the head turned to the side, just like the big head there.
It's a weird, goofy picture of me.
Yeah.
But it's like, if we stick at it long enough, we're going to figure out what to do with it strategically.
Yeah, without That's question.
It. And it's just like training agility.
Yeah, big time play agility.
Yeah.
Make all those big touchdown runs. Oh, man. Imagine the momentum of your body hurling across the field. The force you exert is needed to break the impulse of the biomechanical movement, decelerating the body to quickly accelerate to another direction. Dane, how does this all filter into agility?
I think one of the biggest aspects around agility is looking at like breaking down in its simplest form, and I know I've said this thousands of times on the podcast, is like, to me, the pinnacle point of agile is Barry Sanders. Like,
yeah,
the way he would run, and he would run like a freaking Mack truck, but also cut like a Ferrari.
Yeah, he was. I can only imagine the size of his legs in person.
Well, dude, and I also,
because he wasn't a big.
No, he's like 5'8".
Yeah, he wasn't like overly tall, but like, you know, 220 pounds at 5'8". Like, how thick are you?
So I remember I had a high school football camp where Jeremiah Trotter was the guy who ran the camp.
Uh-huh.
And you got to ask him questions at the end. And this was back when Mike Allstott, and he played against Barry Sanders, Warwick Dunn, all those guys, right? So people were asking him who hit the hardest. And everybody's like, Mike Allstott's got to hit hard. And he's like, Allstott's hard to take down, because he's big. But he doesn't hurt because you have such a big mass to hit. So, like, you can hit him and you're on a broad spectrum of his body. But he was like, he mentioned Wark Dunn was a total savage to hit because he was so small.
Yeah.
And it would run you over. But he was like, Barry Sanders felt like you were running into a wall, like a wall that was moving. And he's like, you just couldn't do anything because you didn't, you never knew where he was cutting. And he could cut with such force that when he was coming out of his cut, he's lowering his shoulder, and there you could only hit him in one spot to really get him down, and he was still bringing.
And his balance was through the roof too.
Yeah, and it's almost like that rigid trunk leads to making it so hard to tackle him. And I think that, you know, to get away from the specific sport of football, but looking at agility in the conversation, it's like if you factor in decelerating, if you factor in accelerating, and then if you factor in like angles, so joint angles, the factor in trunk control, and then I'm trying to think what else.
Like, is there like stopping power in there then too, or do you consider that part of
the deceleration? Yeah, yeah, the stopping power would be like if I can stop the fastest, whoever slows down the fastest is very likely the same individual who can get to their top end the fastest.
Yeah, most. That's a good recipe for having the most agility.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not necessarily.
100%.
And to speak to Barry Sanders, too, I remember being a kid watching him, you know, on TV. Like, he was kind of my idol. Like, I was someone who hated Emmitt Smith. I don't know why. Like, he's incredible. Like,
yeah.
Part of, oh, he
that's
did
just
it.
Just like young kids.
Yeah,
stuff.
He did it so long. Like, no wonder he has the record. It's like, yeah, but that's a testament, too.
Yeah.
To
yeah.
be able to do it that yeah. long, especially in a sport like that at that
There's
position.
A highlight video of Emmitt Smith on YouTube that is the best blocks of Emmitt Smith, and it's guys coming off blitzing and him just decleating him. And it's like that video made me be like, all right, I like him.
Yeah. So, but like little kid me
yeah,
did
he's,
it.
He's played for the Cowboys. Yeah.
That too. That I don't want to say never, but really not a Cowboy fan at all. But like Barry Sanders, I always felt he got like caught.
Yeah, yeah.
Like he could get like a 40, but someone would catch him all the time.
He did have some breakaways though.
He had a lot of breakaways. I remember.
Keep in mind, he played for the Lions as well.
I did have him on my fantasy football team as 2,000-yard rushing season.
Oh, that's
seasons.
Good. Yeah, yeah.
Like when I first started getting into that stuff, I refused to do it now as an adult. I'm like, I'm not wasting my Sunday watching TV all day.
I think that's a good move, by the way. But going back to the
super agile, right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And kind of a predecessor to like what backs do now.
Yeah,
you
yeah,
know,
yeah, for sure.
You got to be able to catch the ball too. You got to go out like.
Yep.
Pre Marshall Faulk, pre LT,
yep,
Priest Holmes, when like the position started changing more and more.
It was a drastic change at that
point.
And I even think like if you think about the virtual summit when in the clip I used, I don't know if you remember the clip I used of Saquon Barkley.
Yeah, with that one handed catch and just stopping.
And it's like that's to me the quintessential modern day agility based football movement. And I think like you look at you know,
so like unilateral breaking power.
Yes.
And a balance within that unilateral breaking power. And that balance comes from stability in the joints and then trunk control as well, right?
Yes.
Like that's the
everything together. And I think that it so the lore, yes, I wanted to move on from the football and Barry Sanders talk, but Barry Sanders was also known to back squat over 600 pounds.
Jeepers.
So it's like the lore of that strength applied at high speed, and I think that's where like the functional group misses out. Like it's strength at speed, and I talked about this where it's like R.A. Roman, who was the weightlifting coach for the Soviet Union for quite a bit in the 70s and 80s, would say there's always a difference between lifting heavyweight and lifting heavyweight fast, and that's the big factor of like it's the same thing in the sports world. So if you're training for agility, you've got to be able to help your athletes chunk at different speeds, chunk movement patterns at different speeds, and then learn how to use that max strength in an agile situation. And like that max strength that might be needed for Jokic hitting a crazy spin.
Yeah, pivot.
Shoot, whatever he's doing, whatever absurd thing he's doing. Is going to be a different level of max strength versus a linebacker scraping down, hitting the hole, and then coming, filling the hole to make the play.
Right.
You know, it's like that's where the strength coach has to be in tune with the sport and the specificity needed for the sport.
Yeah, what type of body type do you need with there? Like,
exactly, yeah.
So in a sport like basketball, you need to be – you need less wobble, right?
Yeah, yeah, like, literally.
Where football, you can get away with having more muscular, lean wobble to you.
Yep.
But basketball, like, it's really not going to pay off for you.
No.
So, all right, maybe you don't need – you don't need a 600-pound back squat in basketball. You don't need it. But you do need a frame that can stay vertical in the air when contact's made.
Yep.
And that, I'm just saying that related to the trunk control, which is a big part of agility. And there's a part of me too that wants to say, like, what's agility like in the air? And I think of like a high jumper, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Try to get in that position.
Yep.
Just
High jumper, pole vaulter.
I don't think I could do it. And I don't consider myself unathletic in any way.
Yeah.
And I don't consider myself unmobile in any way
for sure,
to the point where you have told me when I started training here, you're a little too hypermobile. We need to
You have it. You have the goods. Can you do that?
I'm gonna be a little old to learn.
Well, now now for sure, especially because the high jump is a massive collision between, and I think that's like the other factor, is that if we're looking at agility, it's a collision with, it's a ground reaction force collision is what it is. Your foot versus the planet. What's the energy that you're going to get out of it? Can you use that energy to then change direction and create some illusionary pattern that could help you juke your opponent? And I think that's the other thing, is like the illusionary pattern or the illusion of where you're going is key. And it's all won on the battle with the ground.
And that's something... football, you could say like Mahomes, what he does with his head and his eyes,
yep.
or someone like Joker in basketball,
yep.
or even someone as old as like Magic Johnson with how they would use their head to give that illusion.
Yeah, the classic video of him like...
yeah, look like, away, and it's like everyone, what are you looking at? Let me look over there too, but I'm already seeing over here, you know, the larger periphery of everything.
That's where the trunk control, that trunk control factors in then closer... that with the quiet eye, which we had talked about a little bit, where it's like, I mean, not in this podcast in the past, but where the quiet eye is essentially the ability, you know, think about the classic, and I hope everybody knows this play of Willie Mays hawking down at like 405 feet, a catch directly over his head, and then turning and whipping.
Crazy.
Yeah, and it's like Bo Jackson's, you know, catch on the run, throw a dime to third base. Like, the quiet eye is the connective point between trunk control that you train in the gym and the skill that you're exhibiting on the competitive field.
Yeah.
Like, the bridge is the quiet eye. And it's like, if you don't have the trunk control, you don't have that.
Yeah, because your head, you're a bobblehead.
Yeah, yeah. You're all over the place. Your body is creating too much noise to be able to make the play. Like, Justin Jefferson is likely the master in the NFL currently as a wide receiver of quiet eye. He's got great hands. Like, he's able to run high speed and make absurd catches. So it's like, how can you develop that in a normal kid, in a normal strength training system where, you know, these kids don't have that.
Let's go into that a little bit. So like exercises maybe that I can do that will have me decelerating, accelerating, trunk control in there. And then like unilateral, bilateral, and sort of this quiet eye element as well.
And so maybe, I would,
if we got even more advanced, like how can you do the illusionary practices as well then too? Like,
I would start, like my first thought is always like, you start with some type of slow eccentric pause in the whole front squat or back squat.
So and just to develop the strength aspect of it first.
Yeah, and the trunk. Yeah, the general aspect of the trunk. And then you go into like auditory command. Okay, now you pause and go. Well, now, then if you do auditory command, then you start to bring in the eye where you still have a ball moving over here. Or if I throw a red frisbee, you do a double bounce. If I throw a green frisbee, you do a single bounce out of the bottom.
So like, now there's like a computational thing going on with the brain.
And it sounds hokey, but you can get really strong doing stuff like that. And then as that builds and you go from like a back squat, a single leg squat, a front squat, now you're doing those movement patterns that are going to help develop the general strength. Then you would go into, all right, well, let's do a hide and jump with a pause. Now let's go to a hide and jump with the side
part. So we're getting into plyometrics now.
So now you
away from absolute strength movements into plyometric movements
that are simple.
but still have a tremendous amount of intensity, if you will, because the force put out in a plyometric is equal to, if not higher than
a squat. Yeah. And that's where I would say with like a kid who's in middle school, like I'm thinking about Lincoln right now, like my oldest, like, I don't know, just get him to do stair jumps first. Get him to do jump lunges in place and then pause. Get him to do jump lunges, pause, and then rotate. And it's like, okay, get him to do jump lunges and rotate, or jump lunges to a box. And it's like the development is just like this exploding thought. Now, then you start to bring in, okay, now you got the trunk control at high speeds, you got the trunk control at slower speeds, you got the trunk control with high weight.
So the high speeds plyometrics, slower speeds absolute strength.
Yeah.
All right.
And then you got to teach them how to get super strong with the absolute strength movements, and then teach them how to keep moving twitchy with the fast movements. And then you start
so they don't become a power lifter.
Yes. I mean, yes.
Yeah.
And then you start to factor in jump series, reflexive movements, and those patterns to really build everything out.
Just off the top of your head, I don't think you have this movement. You may. If I'm trying to teach a kid and I want to give him a jump series with a step back into a jumper, what's a plyometric series I could do with that? That like sort of patterning, or even a reflexive movement if you have it.
Okay, so right now I've got two cones here that make a triangle with a point here. You jump forward and you plant on your left, and you jump and rotate and land forward on this one.
So like
one.
A reckless type of very 180 similar, or yeah, a 90 there?
180.
So, all right. So,
but what we can do is alter that, move this back one in a little, jump forward, jump backwards, land on the plate backwards.
So, all right.
Now you want to set it up so it's safe.
Triangle.
Yep.
Me as the athlete, I'm on the base on the left-hand side.
Yep.
I jump forward to the top of the triangle.
And you land. You would land on your right and rotate all the way around.
Land on my right.
And then you would rotate, land on your left on the...
On the left. Yeah. So it's almost like... I'm almost like turning as I go there.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what I would do with that movement, and I think we are terming that basketball series two.
Okay.
We're trying to get better with our naming capacity here. So... The next thing I would do...
You know what? Comment down below if you're watching on YouTube or something. Like, what would be some good names for jump series around like certain movements? We will gladly take suggestions and try to like, all right, here's a movement here, identify it. Because we're only so many eyes too on it. And like,
and we live in a bubble.
Yeah.
So I would then go, okay, you got the base and the point up top. And I would just move this one in a little where it would be like... Okay, I actually just got an idea. You would jump off the left, land on the right, jump over a mini hurdle, land on the left, and jump.
Okay.
And it's like that could be a real easy thing that you do to both sides. And you just, for 3 weeks, it's easy. It's just boom. It's boom, boom, jump. Boom, 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 jump. And it's just like you don't have to get crazy with it. You just have to execute, execute, execute. And then all of a sudden, boom, 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 now you have it. All
right. Now my next thing is, say Dirk Nowitzki, right?
Yeah.
Let's stick with the basketball because it's a little out of your wheelhouse.
Yeah, yeah.
Taman deals a lot with basketball players too, and like it's not something I think you said you consume. Like you don't watch a lot of basketball or haven't like it wasn't something as a kid you would be like, oh, I'm gonna watch the NBA Finals this week or something like that. Dirk Nowitzki worked with his coach. I forget the guy's name, but like developed all his moves off him. Later in Dirk's career, he developed sort of this one-legged step back type of jump.
Yep.
Jump shot where he, like, it was a fade away.
It was like a falling fade.
Yeah, and basically off one leg, knee up, and because he's 7 foot tall, like, it was indefensible almost. Like, maybe Kevin Garnett could defend it. Like,
right.
The best defender, big man defender of the generation type of thing. If I'm trying to... I'm not Dirk Nowitzki. I don't have that. But I want to try to develop that athletic capability as a kid.
Yeah.
What's an exercise, a reflexive exercise maybe that I could do, or how could I start chunking that movement to be able to do something like
that? I would do a single leg. Well, one, again, I would just do single leg squats, skater squats. I would try to develop like walking lunges. Nothing crazy weight, just getting proficient with
developing
the general
requisite
part.
Unilateral strength to even be able to think about performing the
movement. And while I'm doing that, I'd be playing around with like a backwards jump to a vertical jump. I would go backwards. I would watch Nowitzki's breakdown, and I would like to do that myself. And then I would start to go, okay, I'm going to hold a dumbbell in my left hand. I'm going to land and jump off my left foot, and I'm going to do a dumbbell snatch into a hip lock with my right knee. So that would be now I'm starting to add in some weight. Another thing you could do is do like you have a band and you jump backwards in the band and then you jump vertically. And it's like
I'm almost picturing a shot put glide.
Yeah.
To land to hip
absolutely.
Block.
Yeah. And that's where, again, I know I oftentimes will relate things to wrestling or to track.
Well, that doesn't surprise me, mainly because you've coached a world bronze medalist like
in wrestling.
In wrestling, you've coached like field sports more.
Yeah,
but
track.
Like Olympic athletes and stuff and things.
So I look through that lens and I think about someone like Joe Thomas, who is arguably like top three left tackles of all time.
Who was a shot putter, right?
He was a shot putter, and his entire movement pattern was a glide. And it's like what you just said. Why wouldn't we do that? Like, that's what the best of the best of all time. Like, someone took a movement from another sport and then made that their technique in a sport that is as complicated, as complex as football. So for Nowitzki, it's like what you could do with that is I think this is where we hesitate to really expand, because we don't want to be labeled as Joel Seedman. We don't want to be labeled as like the functional guy. But like, dude, I like looking at something like that, and I'm probably going to go home and screen record three Nowitzki highlights. And
yeah.
All right, what can I do to help somebody?
There's some videos of him working out with his coach.
I've seen some of that.
Which is like, it's interesting cool. to watch. Like, you know, they're going back and forth, just doing the same movement over and over
again.
And
that's where I think when you watch a sport like basketball, it's all of the big moves that you see are all chunked portions of a more meta thing. Like, you look at like a movement that Nowitzki did, he practiced thousands of times. It wasn't something he made up, but then he sequenced them together. And so it looks crazy, but it's a sequence of things that he's chunked in the past.
Yeah. I forget where I read it, but it's one of the things I live by.
Yeah.
Like, I want to do something complicated. I want it to look complex. And it's just like, well, I have to do a simple thing on top of a simple thing.
Yeah.
And at some point, all the simple things come up and it looks really crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, go ahead and just write 0 and 1 over and over again.
Listen
for a bit.
Okay. So, dude, it's so funny that you said this, because I was talking with Rudy Winkler about Ode to Joy again. And he and I all have these classical music discussions. And I played in the song Promontory from Last of the Mohicans. It's like it's just like one of those songs that I could listen to if I was going to battle. Like, I just love it. But we were literally saying that, like, listen to Ode to Joy. And if you don't like it, you probably don't have a soul, first of all. But if you really think about it, it's just it's people singing 30 instruments going at once. But everybody at one moment they're playing one note.
Yeah.
And everybody's playing one note. But then they're doing that 90 times in a moment because of the layers of sound over top of it. And that's what makes it so complex. So what you just said is not just accurate for basketball or wrestling or football. It's literally life. It's like,
it's like a universal thing.
Yeah, it's like, what the hell? That's literally that easy.
Yeah. Get your how do I say it? Find your inspiration from something outside of what you do to impact what you do. And I don't know. We're getting philosophical. Someone's going to comment about how podcast starts here.
Yo, that's hilarious.
I think we have to get into the overrated, underrated.
All right, let's go.
Man, felt like we could have kept going too, but this is where we're at. Don't forget the range bar. If you're ever like going for a hike, a few hours.
Big hike.
Man. Swear, I could do 2 sessions on one of these. Like, I could do an AM and PM.
Well, I'm going to try and do a 16-mile run on Saturday.
Oh, you definitely got to take one with you.
Should I have one of these?
All right. I think I put this in here because we were going to talk about plyometrics. We didn't. And I put this one in here because of upper body stuff. But it may also be accommodating resistance, too. banded push-ups. Overrated, underrated?
Oh, that's tough because, like, I like using them. Honestly, I think they're probably underrated. I would say they're underrated because I don't see people do them a lot.
Yeah, they smoke you in such a
my
weird way, too.
My triceps get so swole. Like,
and I don't know why.
And it's always like it just feels like it's blasting out of the back of my arm. Yeah, I like it because of the tension at the top. And I think, too, it's like you can feel it in your pecs more so than you would a typical
push-up. And there's like extra DTC in there, too.
Yeah.
Like everyone forgets, you know, like you do a push-up, like you're in a plank. Like,
yep.
And if you do the push-up like a gymnast does it, like, and you hollow body to it, like.
Yeah, you're like that. Like, yeah. Really squeezing
and
it.
I see this in my young son. Like when he does his push-up, it's not a lack of upper body strength that it looks horrible.
It's he sinks it's, and then
it's,
waves
he worms
up.
It because he doesn't hold it. Like the trunk part is what's missing.
100%.
All right. Next one. Overrated, underrated.
Oh, God.
Here agility we go. Ladders.
Overrated. They like the agility. Okay. I've gotten flack for this. The agility ladder is 100% overrated. However, I will say there's things that you can do that are beneficial from it. I think it's a great warm-up. I think it's good. I think you can set up moves off of it. Like you could say, like, I'm gonna come out like a 10-yard sprint and I'm gonna plant in this agility ladder and cut out. Or maybe I'm gonna go plant and then like a jump cut out of it. Whatever, right? I think it's a good warm-up. I think there's a way you can use it. I've used it with Nick's group. We would do it sometimes where we would have like the sled. And then it was like active rest. We would do footwork with it.
Okay,
I think that's effective. And again, the targeted cuts, but like guys just live on it and live on it. And then you get them on the field to actually run, and it's like, dude, you're slow. Like, come on, you just pull sleds.
Feels like it's to your thing, like the overrated. It's an overused tool.
Yeah.
Like
way,
you're prescribing it too much.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. There's way bigger things that you can attack.
All right, overrated, underrated, parachutes.
Overrated because the wind differential changes drastically and you can't actually measure that on a regular basis.
Lack of a constant.
Yeah. So there's a lack of a constant. There's not a ton of research on them. And my understanding, actually, there's a book up there called like the Soviet Training Principles. And they talked about Valery Borzov, who won the Olympics in the 100 meters in 1972, was telling people that he had trained with parachutes, and that's sort of like when all the lore started. And like it came back that like he did like 10 sessions with them or something, and it was like not so, like Charlie Francis came out and was like, I asked Borzov about it, or Borzov, whatever his name was, and he didn't really do that. Like that's not what he was.
Yeah, it was like it was almost, I don't want to say like, but it was the functional part of his whole training. Like it was something he did do. But it wasn't the
training.
Bread and butter.
No,
like,
yeah.
It was sort of like, you know, maybe a seasoning you put on it.
They actually took, well, yeah. Dude, rumor is they came up with this contraption to like piece him in and they could move it at like sub 10 second speeds.
Okay.
And
so it would like drag him.
Yeah, it would be like an overspeed training that was on a track. And that was like the rumor that I've heard. Like I remember Dr. B even saying like he didn't ever work with a guy, but he's pretty sure that's what he was doing.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I'm just going to speed you up a little bit. Fast forward.
Yeah, and you're going to have to learn it. I'm sure he was doing drugs too.
2x speed. Here we go.
Yeah, exactly. All
right. Either or.
Hey, by the way, I wanted to bring up my mistake from last week.
Oh, go ahead. Do you want me
the
to
roots?
Do
the roots are better than Jedi mind tricks.
You convinced yourself this week? Just so everyone knows, Dane might have like voxed me 4 times this week, telling me how sorry he was he answered that way. And he's like, I've been listening to Black Thought. I've been listening to The Roots. I've been listening to Things Fall Apart. I've been listening to Do You Want More? I've been listening to all this stuff. And he's just like, I don't even know why I said that now.
It's like sometimes I just have my reaction and I don't filter it.
Like I've never seen him lament something so much over like a.
I just wanted to bring it up how I felt.
Yeah, I can I have records. I have receipts of it too.
Yeah, that's true. I got receipts.
Yeah.
I got receipts.
All right, either or. You better answer this one correctly.
Oh, geez. More pressure.
Now, I know you don't have maybe the cultural one with this because it's just not your.
Yeah.
All right. Darkseid or Thanos?
You're asking because of your shirt.
Yeah.
Darkseid, come on.
Good. I'm glad you answered correctly.
Can I just comment? You said Darkseid, and the first thing that popped into my head was Darkseid of the Moon, and I was going to jump all over Darkseid. I was going to be like, oh, Darkseid, dude. All you right. have no idea.
That's okay with the connotation.
And then you said Thanos, and I was like, is that a King Crimson album that I never listened to? Like, literally, that was my thought process. No, was like, no, that wasn't a King Crimson album.
I wish I was that cool to do, like, prog rock stuff for you.
Well, then I went through, like, their first four albums. I'm like, oh, didn't they have one called Red and Court of the Crimson King?
I think, was it Yes or King Crimson? I think someone else, it wasn't me, but someone I was, like, we were working out, was playing King Crimson. It was putting something on from the 90s, maybe, by him. I think it was King Crimson.
Dude, they have a song called Thela Hunjinjit. It is so good, and it's from, like, 91. Thela Hunjinjit.
It may have been, whatever it was a doom metal track.
Okay, this was, this.
And I was just like, this is, like, it's not like I don't like it. I don't listen to it. Like, I haven't dived into the discography. Like, I still, like, buy music. I don't stream music. Like, I'd be overwhelmed with that much choice. I wouldn't know what to do.
I love that much choice, dude.
I wouldn't know what to do with myself. All right, let's get to the audience question.
Just reminds me of college.
Oh, oh, this is from Discord.
Oh, nice. Let's go.
We're over 1,000.
Have we ever had a Discord question?
Yes.
Okay.
Constantly.
I always thought it was coming. I was thinking YouTube community. Sorry.
This is Jesus is American.
All right.
Is what their name is. Yo, I'm pretty sure too in our Discord that is the legit. What's his name?
Tarakti.
I'm pretty sure.
I talked to him in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah. If that's not him, that's definitely. I'm pretty sure it's his rep. Like,
it might be him or Putsoff.
Yeah. Who like does it? Because I went in the like profile and clicked the link tree and it's like
legit.
It's what it is, like it's all his stuff. So welcome, very happy.
All
right, Jesus is American. How long does it take to lose muscular endurance or speed endurance? I've been just playing basketball for 3 weeks now without lifting, and at first my technique was getting sharper, but now I feel like my CNS isn't firing like it used to.
Muscular endurance or speed endurance? Muscular endurance from who was it that just posted a whole paper on breakdown of endurance? It takes like 25 to 30 days. Muscular or speed endurance, so like speed is more like 14 to like 18 days. So you're probably noticing your speed breakdown a lot faster. You're not going to lose muscular endurance necessarily when you're playing basketball or whatever sport, because you're still getting endurance based work. Now, you might notice it locally. If you go in and do like a set of bench press and you're like, man, my pecs are shot because you haven't been training locally, but globally you wouldn't notice it. The endurance wise, you would speed wise, you would certainly notice it within two and a half weeks.
Man.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Thanks, Jesus is American, for helping me learn something today. This is from the YouTube community.
Okay.
Even though lately, one of the people I follow on Twitter just wrote like a New York Times bestselling book, and I didn't know this, but YT is the shorthand for white, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Like, see, taught you something, too. Yeah. So every time I see, I know it's YouTube here, but anyway.
Yeah, then you see it, and you're like, white.
Yeah. YouTube community, Alan Moran 9551, at Alan Moran. What explosive strength exercises do you recommend for boxing? Any suggestions on footwork speed drills? Thanks.
Explosive, okay, so we just did a knockout boxing video. I would say like shuffle side med ball shot put throws is probably my favorite, like a shuffle shot put throw for explosiveness in the trunk to the upper body. I actually think what I would do, one, I would do general plyometrics pretty frequently.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually break it down in the video where I would say you should do plyometrics like 60 minutes a week. So like two bouts of 30 minutes probably, But then I would also meet, like, if I had a fighter who came to me and was like, yo, I want to hire you to be one of my coaches to help me win a world title, I would break down their three best moves. I would look at how they set them up, and then I would watch their opponent, and I would literally watch hours of their opponent. And then I would come up with a series on how their opponent moves and set up the plyometric off of that opponent's patterns. And that would be how we would set up their
man,
offense.
You just gave that away for free.
Yeah, I mean, it would take a lot to do it, but I would love to do something
like
that.
Well, the work would take time, but like the whole mindset and what needs to be done to make it happen. Like,
yeah.
You're all welcome out there. Me too. Thank you for sharing that with me.
No problem.
I appreciate it.
Try it.
That's all we got. Big play agility, dude.
Big play agility.
Knockout agility
up,
at the end
out,
there.
Yeah, and make sure that you can decelerate at the fastest clip possible. Until next time, peace.